In this session, we are going to use the knowledge we acquired while learning psychrometry, which was all about understanding the interplay between moisture, temperature, and thermal comfort, and see how we can use that knowledge to first understand the conditions that will be experienced by the building and the occupants to be able to design passive buildings in the future. In this session, we are first going to understand how to conduct climate analysis for any site in which you might be constructing a building. And then we will emphasize a few interesting teaching aids which can be employed by teachers to generate interest about climate analysis so that their students are primed to design socially thoughtful and environmentally responsible buildings. The key takeaways from this for teachers would be that the students would be able to prioritize the reduction of cooling loads and passive design strategies before they look to employ active strategies or renewable energies, which have traditionally been thought of as being the mainstay of sustainable design. We will also ensure that the teachers and academics who use this knowledge are also equipped with teaching methods, activities which they can use to generate interest about the subject and create empathy amongst the students for passive design. And finally, what are the design elements about the climate that will directly influence the shape, structure, and form of the building will also be conveyed in this training session. Right, so let's start with climate analysis. All right, the precursor knowledge that is required before we embark upon an understanding of climate analysis is that India currently is defined by 5 distinct climatic zones, as depicted in the image here. The red area stands for hot and dry regions of India. The orange stands for the warm and humid. As you can imagine, they are mainly the coastal areas where the temperature difference is not very high between day and night. Then a bulk of India falls under what's called the composite climate zone. There's a small pocket of what's called the temperate, or almost like a northern climate zone in India, which is centered around the Bengaluru, Mysore area in southern Karnataka. And finally, the cold climate zone. Each of these has its own psychrometric traits and conditions, which we will explore in a short while. We are also trying to allude through this that buildings designed in each of these climate zones will have a different set of challenges and a different set of thermal comfort parameters that would have to be met based on the psychrometric and solar conditions outside. Right. So we will learn to demystify charts like this through understanding climate analysis. So very quickly, let me just delve into what this chart represents. This was also addressed in our analysis of thermal comfort in the prior training session. This here on the x-axis is the dry bulb temperature of the psychrometric chart. On the y-axis, you can see we have humidity, absolute humidity values. Each of these dots represents 1 hour's worth of data collection, which is then conveyed as an average temperature and humidity value. And the placement of these dots on this chart and the clustering should give some intuitive feel for the kind of climatic conditions that will be endured by occupants in this city. So we'll look at answering which is the possible city that this represents in a short while. All right, so this is a chart which indicates a lot of clustering around the high humidity region, which is close to saturation line. As you can see, very few hours are present in this area, which is the dry and hot part of the psychrometric chart. So of course, this is not a hot and dry place. This is most likely a humid place. And whether it is a hot and humid or a warm and humid, we will only be able to detect once we see the corresponding charts for other regions. But most likely, this is the chart for a warm and wet region of India. This is a chart, as you can see, with a lot of clustering near the saturation line, which again indicates periods of relatively high humidity, but the temperatures are not as high in general as the previous chart. So this place is again humid, but not as hot as the as the previous one. So perhaps we can call the previous one a hot and wet, or hot and humid climate zone, and this one is more of a warm and humid climate zone. This one here, of course, shows that the temperature regime is much colder than the previous two psychrometric charts. However, the humidity is still on the higher side. As you can see, a lot of clustering. We might be able to call this what's called a cold and humid climate zone. So this could be something like a place near Himachal Pradesh in Shimla, which has overcast conditions at most times of the year, but also is relatively cold. Let's return to the first image of the chart that we, the psychrometric chart that we saw. This indicates a broad spread of psychrometric conditions or climatic conditions. As you can see, you can span all the way from 40 degrees down to about 5 degrees. So that's a very broad spread. It also has times of the year where the humidity is high, though not so gruelingly high that, you know, it would cause a lot of discomfort, but sufficiently for some parts of the year, it's near the saturation zone. But for most parts of the year, the humidity levels are moderate. This is a classic composite climate zone psychrometric chart. What we'd like to emphasize from this set of images is that in the process of designing a building, say you do acquire a psychrometric chart from your air conditioning consultant or some data source, the mere visual sort of sensation that these kinds of clustering should create should immediately tell the designer that this certainly cannot be a hot and humid city's climate chart. This is the kind of instinctive feel we believe eventually building designers, students, etc. need to acquire. We might not be able to nail down which city this is, but we should certainly be able to say which city this is most likely not. For example, this cannot be a Chennai. This most likely is a chart for something like a Delhi or perhaps something like a Pune, which is could be considered a composite climate zone chart. Let's revisit the idea of the juxtaposition of the comfort zone against the climate data for a city and the relative spacing of the clustering of psychrometric data points versus the comfort zone should be able to indicate how easy it will be to cool or heat a building up. This is the psychrometric chart for a hot and humid city such as Chennai. And as you can see, even if you had a very liberal definition of a comfort zone using the Indian model for adaptive comfort, for instance, you would have quite a few hours, a large number of hours, where you would still need artificial cooling or some sort of advanced passive design to make these psychrometric data points lie within the comfort zone. So this is one of the merits of doing a climate analysis in juxtaposition with the thermal comfort zone, right? And this is what all our passive and active cooling systems are constantly trying to do, right? The chart here has taken away those individual data points and now has classified each of the regions of the psychrometric chart. And in a later training session on passive design, we will see that passive design strategies are actually clustered around the kind of climate zone that the pre-existing psychrometric conditions are in, and what are the strategies, the passive design strategies, say ventilation, thick walls, shading, smaller windows, thicker insulation, for example. Which strategy would be applicable if the data or the psychrometric conditions were in this part of the chart? Which passive strategies would be useful in this part of the chart, this part of the chart, so on and so forth, eventually all driving the psychrometric reality to live within the comfort zone, irrespective of what definition of comfort zone you come up with, right? The previous charts that we showed you for the various cities have all been sourced from this very potent and useful freeware out there on the internet called Climate Consultant. It has psychrometric weather charts for every Indian city and of course every other major global city. This, for example, is a chart which shows, taken from Climate Consultant, is the relative frequency of days with a certain dry bulb temperature. And for example, this is for the city of Ahmedabad. And as you can see, that the frequency for temperatures which are above 30 is much higher than the frequency, or sorry, between 20 and 30 is much higher than the frequency for days which are less than, for example, 15 or below. So this is a relatively warm place because the clustering or the frequency is more to the right hand side. So this is one piece of data that's available from the psychrometric, from the climate consultant software. The climate consultant software has weather data files which include temperature, humidity, wind speed, radiation, and we'll show you pictorial depictions of all of these. And there are softwares which can directly absorb this information in electronic form and use it for the modeling exercises, simulations for doing building energy modeling. These are other sources beyond Climate Consultant for where you can get data for either your projects if you are a practicing professional, or if you are a teacher and you want to use this kind of data in your classroom. These are all the valid sources of weather data. They all essentially have the same information about a city. So irrespective of which source you use, you should end up with relatively similar information about psychrometric conditions, solar radiation, etc. These are some very quick outputs from the Climate Consultant software. Again, these are some of the questions you could use as part of an exercise, a classroom exercise, using that tool which is available online. Here, for example, is the information about humidity levels in Pune. And depending on the color of the pixel, that indicates the relative humidity prevalent throughout the year from January to December, and in those months from 12 p.m. to, from midnight to 12 p.m., right? So this indicates whether the city is a relatively dry or a relatively wet city. So for example, the question here is, months with comfortable humidity conditions, which is 40 to 60% during a work day, what is the answer for this? We will get to know. Extra dry months, where is the humidity very low? And here, low humidity is indicated by darker blue colors. So we can see that the relatively dry months are in February, March, April. The time of the day with least chances of rainfall, which means very high humidity. The times of the day when you have least chance of rainfall during the monsoon would again be the very dry parts of June to September. So we can figure out perhaps that it's these light red pixels where you have less chance of rainfall, which is between, for example, 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. You're unlikely to have rainfall in the city at that time. Most of the rain will happen either early in the morning or later because the humidity levels are very high. So these are the kinds of useful climate inputs that you can pick up from climate consultant software to help you design your building more thoughtfully. Yes, so here is the answer, which corroborates what we just said. Months with comfortable humidity conditions during a workday, that's November to December, right? So that's here. During the workday, you have relatively moderate humidity, right? Whereas here, it's very, very low humidity. It's too dry during the workday. The second question is extra dry months are months with less than 20% humidity. That's these months with the dark blue. That's March and April. And 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. is where you have the least chance, as we had indicated earlier, of getting rainfall in the city of Pune during the monsoon months. This is a chart which shows you the solar radiation levels that are prevalent throughout the year. This can help you size shading devices. This can help you look at which areas of the building are likely to get hot at what times of the year. So you can look at if you have a building which has annual usage changing depending on whether it's, say, for example, a hotel which has a tourist season, you will get a sense of which are the months where you're going to get a lot of punishing solar radiation, and perhaps you try and avoid air conditioning in those parts of the building, so on and so forth. So that's what this chart could be very useful for, the solar radiation chart. Here are a couple of questions you could ask yourself. Months with maximum solar radiation, right? And that clearly is indicated by these taller bars here. This is global radiation in terms of, I think it's watt per meter square, if I'm not mistaken. And on the x-axis, you have your months. During which months will solar panels be least effective, right? least effective solar panel months would be months where solar radiation is grossly inadequate, and that is most likely to be the monsoon months, right, where the solar radiation is the least. So let's see what the answers to that are. Yes, so Jan to April are the months with maximum solar radiation, as you can see. All right, so your solar panels will be very effective, and the months where it's least effective is June to September, because the solar radiation is very low. The final other piece of data that you can use from Climate Consultant, it's a very powerful tool, is to look at the prevailing wind directions for a certain location. This again is for the city of Pune, Maharashtra. And this here is the legend that you would need to be able to read this chart. Now this tells you the wind speeds. As you go from the center, the wind speeds are the highest, and as you go out, the wind speeds reduce. And this tells you also the humidity. So this is a very comprehensive chart that tells you the humidity of the breeze that's also coming in, right? It's telling you the temperature of the air that's coming in and the number of hours that this will be blowing, or the wind will be blowing in this direction. So for example, here you can tell that in terms of number of hours, the longest yellow part is in this side, the due west side. So most of the breezes in Pune, more than about 20%, will be coming in. Actually, this is 10, 20, about 22% of the time the wind is coming from the western side, for instance. Now, it also tells you that the humidity of that wind, here if you look at the color, it's more in the dark range, which means it will be relatively high humidity when it comes from the west. For example, the temperature will sort of be in the average range. It's in the blue and gray, it's about here. So it's a moderate sort of temperature wind when it comes there. This could be, of course, used very beneficially to design ventilation systems where you can use the prevailing wind, channel it to bring in fresh air, also exhaust pollutants, improve air quality, so on and so forth. So this can also help you orient your ventilation systems and your building as a whole by looking at what's called these wind rose diagrams. This is what they are called. Right? So here are the answers to these questions: maximum wind speed, prevailing direction. So here, prevailing direction, as you can tell, is west, because this is where you see most of the wind coming from. The psychrometric charts, like we had indicated, are available in the Climate Consultant software. Another feature that we should perhaps bear in mind is that you can turn on a feature which allows you to estimate which kind of passive design strategy will be applicable for different times of the year in this city. So in Pune, if my goal is to have this as my comfort zone and get my psychrometric data points into this box, there's a whole host of passive design strategies which can be used, which are only applicable for certain times of the year, right? So the numbers are not really showing up here, but essentially what we are seeing here is that there are sun shading of windows, high thermal mass walls, natural ventilation, internal heat gain, so on and so forth. And when you turn this feature on, it tells you how many hours will each of these strategies be useful for. So for example, it tells us direct evaporative cooling will most likely work here. What is the number of hours where I can use that process to take these dots and bring them into the center? This will give me a sense of how effective a certain strategy will be, which ones I should discard, which ones I should focus on, so on and so forth. And it also tells you the comfortable hours. So the comfortable hours in this case are 7.2% of the hours are already within the comfort zone in this city. Okay, so psychrometry and climate analysis are to some degree abstract, though of course we can activate sensory mechanism, experiential learning very, very effectively for building interest in the idea of climate analysis. And another activity that you could do here, which is actually what we had suggested even for ingraining the idea of psychrometry and its importance, and also generate interest, is to simulate climatic conditions of various cities in different classrooms using, for example, humidifiers, dehumidifiers, sources of heat, sources of cooling, such as an air conditioner or a whole set of tumblers filled with ice, which will simulate cooling, so on and so forth. So this, we believe, is a very effective way to build muscle memory and associative memory related to psychrometrics and climate analysis. This concludes our training on the use of psychrometry to analyze the data for the climate of a certain size, of a certain site, to be able to then design passive buildings which use as little energy as possible to provide thermal comfort to its occupants. If you have further questions, please do not hesitate to get in touch with us on our email addresses or through our portal fairconditioning.org. Thank you.